In the previous lecture, we saw the phasor diagram for the ideal transformer in no load condition. In this lecture, we will understand the phasor diagram for ideal transformer when a load is connected across the secondary. If the switch is closed, then the secondary of this ideal transformer is connected to the load, and this load can be resistive load or R load, inductive load or RL load, and capacitive load or RC load in nature. Then there will be a current in the load as well as in the secondary winding. Depending upon the load, the magnitude of the current flowing through the load is I2, and the phase angle between the voltage across the load or V2 and the current flowing in the secondary or I2 will be different as the load is varied from resistor to inductor and finally to capacitor. Now, according to the Lenz law, this current should oppose its cause. The load current in the secondary winding or I2 is generated due to the EMF induced in the secondary winding or E2. The induced EMF is generated due to the electromagnetic induction of the alternating flux phi m. So the current in the load or in the secondary winding should generate a flux whose direction is exactly opposite to the main flux flowing in the core or phi m. Now the current flowing in the secondary winding through the load is equal to I2. If we take the direction of this current I2 from left to right, this current induces a magnetomotive force N2I2. This magnetomotive force N2I2 in the secondary winding generates a flux. Let's say the generated flux in the secondary winding due to the current I2 is equal to Phi2. The direction of the generated flux Phi2, which is due to the current through the load I2, can be determined by thumb rule, and this generated flux Phi2 will be exactly opposite to the main flux Phi m flowing in the core. So the main flux Phi m is decreased by an amount equal to Phi2, which is generated due to the magnetomotive force N2I2. So our new main flux or phi m prime is equal to phi m minus phi 2. Now we know that transformer is a constant flux device. That's why this main flux phi m, which is generated due to the magnetizing current I mu, should remain constant regardless of any change in the load. So in order to keep this main flux phi m constant, we have to increase the flux phi m by an equal amount to the generated flux phi 2 due to the magnetomotive force N2I2. The main flux phi m is generated by the current flowing in the primary, which is previously equal to the magnetizing current I mu. In order to increase the main flux by an equal amount, we have to increase the current supply in the primary winding, or in other words, primary must develop the magnetomotive force which will exactly counterbalance the secondary magnetomotive force or N2I2. So the generated flux in the secondary winding, if we have a resistive load, then Phi2 is equal to N2I2 by R. Now, the new current in the primary winding under loaded condition is I1. So the new magnetomotive force under the loaded condition in primary winding is N1I1. Magnetomotive force under no load condition in the primary winding was N1I mu. So the extra magnetomotive force that the current in the primary needs to produce equal to magnetomotive force due to the current flowing in the secondary winding or N2I2. For this extra magnetomotive force to be produced in primary, an extra current I2 prime flows along with magnetizing current I mu. So the primary current I1 is equal to I mu plus I2 prime. And for this additional current I2 prime, extra magnetomotive force generated in the primary winding is equal to N1 I2 prime. So from the magnetomotive force balance equation, we can say that new magnetomotive force in the primary winding is equal to magnetomotive force in the primary winding under no load condition plus the magnetomotive force required in the primary winding to neutralize the demagnetizing effect of the secondary current I2. Hence, N1 I1 is equal to N1 I mu plus N1 I2 prime. This N1 I2 prime is equal to N2 I2. So we can say that N1 I2 prime is equal to N2 I2. From where we can calculate the value I2 prime as N2 by N1 into I2. This N2 by N1 is known as K or voltage transformation ratio. So based on the value of voltage transformation ratio K, the magnitude of these two current I2 and I2 prime can be determined. Thus, when an ideal transformer is loaded and carries a secondary current I2, then a current I1 must flow in the primary winding to maintain the magnetomotive force balance. In other words, primary must draw enough current to neutralize the demagnetizing effect of the secondary current so that the main flux remains constant. So when the current in the secondary increases, the current in the primary must increase in unison to maintain the main flux constant, and the power input automatically increases with the output. Now let's see the Phasor diagram for the ideal transformer in the loaded condition. At first you will take the main flux phi m as reference, then both the EMF E1 and E2 are in phase with each other and they both lag the reference flux phi m by an angle of 90 degree. The both E1 and E2 are antiphase with the supply alternating voltage V1, or both of the EMF are 180 degree out of phase with the supply alternating voltage V1. This is because the self-induced voltage E1 is equal to minus V1 and the mutually induced voltage E2 is equal to minus K into V1, where K is the voltage transformation ratio. As this is an ideal transformer and there is no loss in the secondary induced voltage to the voltage across the load, that's why E2 is equal to V2. Depending upon the turn ratio K, E1 can be greater than E2 or E1 can be less than E2. Now this magnetizing current IMU is purely inductive current. In other words, it will lag the alternating supply voltage V1 by an angle of 90 degree and it is very small in magnitude. This aspect remains constant for both ideal transformer operating without a load and an ideal transformer operating with a load. Now we will consider a load that is connected across the secondary of the ideal transformer. Then the current I2 will be flowing through the load and this creates a magnetomotive force N2I2 which creates a flux Phi2, and to oppose this flux an addition and current I2 prime flows in the primary winding. So the primary current is the sum of magnetizing current and the additional current I2 prime, or I1 is equal to IMU plus I2 prime. Now based on the load, the current in the secondary winding or I2 will vary, which causes the I2 prime to vary as well. Relationship between these two current is I2 prime is equal to K into I2. So I2 prime can be drawn after drawing the I2. In order to draw I2, we need to consider three different loads. Hence, there will be three different Phasor diagrams. If we consider the load is resistive, then the I2 will be in phase with the secondary EMF E2 or voltage across the load V2. As I2 is equal to K into I2 prime, the additional current I2 prime will also be in phase with the supply voltage V1. Based on the value of K, either I2 prime or I2 will be greater, and by the vector sum of IMU and I2 prime, we can determine the primary winding current I1. If the load is inductive or RL load is connected across the secondary, then I2 will lag the secondary EMF E2 by an angle of phi, and as the additional current I2 prime is exactly opposite to the secondary current I2, it will lag the supply voltage V1 by an angle of phi. Based on the value of K, either I2 prime or I2 will be greater by the vector sum of magnetizing current IMU and an additional current I2 prime, we can determine the primary current I1. If the load is capacitive or an RC load is connected across the secondary, then the secondary current I2 will lead the secondary EMF E2 by an angle of phi. As the additional current I2 prime is exactly opposite to the secondary current I2, it will lead the supply voltage V1 by an angle of phi. Based on the value of K, either I2 prime or I2 will be greater by the vector sum of magnetizing current IMU and additional current I2 prime, we can determine the primary current I1. This concludes our discussion for this lecture. In the event that you have any question regarding this presentation, feel free to post them in the comment section and don't forget to hit the subscribe button. See you in the next one.